Jesus was a bad son. Seriously. At least by the standards of the culture, the ancient Palestinian Jewish culture in which he was raised, Jesus fell pretty short of the expectations, of the standards that people have for what a son was supposed to be. See, in order to be a good son in Jesus' society, there were at least three things that you had to do that Jesus didn't do. First of these, maybe the biggest, is in order to be a good son, you had to get married and have children. This was how you preserved your family's lineage, and it was how you brought your family honor. What's more, getting married and having kids boosted your family's economic welfare, right? You were creating an allegiance between two families, and eventually you were creating offspring who would, in time, contribute to the family's livelihood. If you think there's social pressure now to get married, or if you think there was social pressure to get married when you were growing up, that's nothing compared to back in biblical times. Back then, everyone, at least every decent person, settled down, got married, and had kids. But not Jesus. Second, in order to be a good son, you had to stay put. That is, in Jesus' society, families almost always lived together. If not under the same roof, then at least in very close proximity with each other. That was so that family members could take care of each other when times got tough, as times often did in ancient agrarian societies. And although Jesus stuck around for quite a while, he worked as a carpenter, he did contribute to his family's livelihood for a while. By the time he hit his late 20s, early 30s, he wasn't staying put any longer. Rather, he was gallivanting from town to town with a group of buddies, always on the move, always bringing controversy wherever they went. This was not a respectable lifestyle choice. In fact, it would have seemed to many downright irresponsible. Lastly, in order to be a good son in Jesus' society, you had to financially support your parents and your older relatives when they needed it. This is related to the whole notion of staying put, right? As family, you're supposed to take care of each other. And if Jesus wanted to, the way I see it, he could have made a pretty penny, even as he was on the move, right? He had crowds of people following him, adoring him and abhorring him, talking nonstop about his controversial speeches and actions. There's always a buck to be made from a scandal, right? And if Jesus had wanted to, he could have made money as he went about as an eccentric prophet and healer. Could have used that money to support his family like any good son would do. Throughout his ministry, though, Jesus clearly tells his disciples that they are to own and to spend as little as possible. Throughout the Gospels, we see that Jesus was intentionally poor, which meant that he was not doing, was failing to do what good sons were supposed to. All three of these things, right, getting married and having kids, staying put, making money to support your family, all of these things were especially expected of a firstborn son. Right? As the firstborn, Jesus is supposed to be the leader, the example setter, one who works hardest to meet the standards that society has set for families. That's not who Jesus was. And our short passage this morning confirms it in a rather shocking exchange. Here Jesus is speaking to yet another crowd of people when his mother and his siblings stop by to speak with him. We don't know why. Presumably there's some family matter that merits Jesus' attention. Perhaps a loved one has become ill. Or perhaps it's nothing serious. Perhaps it's something trivial. Regardless, the only decent thing for Jesus to do in this situation is for him to stop what he's doing, Go and see what his mother and his siblings want. Instead, Jesus does the unthinkable. Not only does he appear to not honor his family's request to come and speak with them, but he actually appears to snub them. Who's my mother? Who are my siblings? Imagine you were Jesus' mom, Jesus' brother, Jesus' sister. How would that make you feel if you happened to overhear that? Shocking as this response is, it's actually in line with Jesus' decisions in recent years. Deciding not to get married and have kids, deciding not to stay put, deciding not to financially support, not to work on financially supporting his family. It seems that Jesus has already decided before this passage to shake off society's expectations and to do family differently. I want to offer just two main points in reflection on this admittedly weird passage. First, as you can imagine, there was tension in Jesus' family surrounding these decisions, surrounding his ministry in general, in fact. Chapter 3 of Mark's Gospel, pretty early on in the story, we read that chapter, we learn that Jesus' family feared he was unstable, even perhaps possessed, early on in his healing ministry. Chapter 7 of John's Gospel suggests that some of Jesus' siblings taunted him in his ministry, refusing to believe that he was anything special. And all of this familial tension, right, it began before Jesus was even born. Teenage Mary gets pregnant while she's still engaged to Joseph, and a local scandal embroils the couple. Actually, this scandal lived on into Jesus' adulthood, as we see throughout the Gospels as well. In chapters 8 and 9 of John's Gospel, some of Jesus' opponents try to shame him for the circumstances under which he was born. No doubt the stigma that Jesus' family had long endured compounded the tension and conflict that his family experienced over his unconventional decisions. In fact, it's possible that all of this, this tension, this conflict, ultimately divided Jesus' family. Have you ever noticed that after Jesus' childhood, Joseph, Mary's husband, never shows up? He's not in any of the stories after Jesus' childhood. He's not around during Jesus' ministry, not around during the crucifixion, not around ever. From Jesus' late childhood on, Joseph is absent from the story. Tradition has taught us that Joseph died by the time Jesus became the adult. It's certainly possible. The text never tells us anything about that. Picking up on clues in the Gospels, some scholars think it is just as likely that Joseph just left. Had enough of the stigma and scandal, he just abandoned his family and all their strained relations. Regardless, all of this goes to say, Jesus himself didn't have the perfect family, whatever that would look like. Jesus was familiar with tension and division within his family. It's okay when we are too. Second and final main point about this passage, Jesus is inviting us, I think, to redefine and widen our understanding of the true family. I don't think he's actually trying to snub his mother and his siblings in this passage. Rather, I think he's trying to get his followers to start imagining new, more expansive ways of being family. Given this, I think it's a little ironic that so many Christians in recent decades have made such a fuss over the nuclear family. Right? There's all this rhetoric about protecting the traditional family, when it seems obvious to me from the Gospels that Jesus was advocating for very much a non-traditional family. Jesus encourages us to envision family beyond biology. Jesus invites us to seek kinship, not just based on blood, but based on the Spirit. When I lived in Jordan, the boarding school for deaf children where I worked would hold a Bible study every Tuesday night. About 15 or so students would attend. I remember one night, it was about 10 p.m., leaving the chapel with half a dozen or so boys, young male students, going back to the boarding house for the night. I'm escorting them back to the boarding house, and a 13-year-old boy named Mohammed gives me a hug, huge hug, squeezes me tightly, and starts joking and jumping, hold me, carry me back to the boarding house. He's 13. I laughed when I signed to him, you are too old and I am too weak for your 13-year-old body. He lets go of me, we keep walking. A few seconds later, I feel a tug on my sleeve. I turn and I see Motasa, 10-year-old deaf boy with bright blue eyes. I sign, what? What do you want? He just looks up at me and signs, I'm only 10. It took me a second to realize what he was asking. And another second or two for me to decide. Scoop him up. Carry him. As he clings tightly to my body. We make our way to the boys' boarding house, which is about 40 yards and 40 steps up away. Beside a few short giggles, he is silent and still. What kind of 10-year-old boy likes being carried? I have to imagine the kind who wasn't carried enough when he was 3. The kind who's old enough to know that his biological father has failed him, but still young enough to delight in pretending with someone else. Is there a Motasa in your life right now? Someone whose biological family is not measuring up? Someone who could use even just a few minutes of Christian kinship? And maybe that's you. Maybe you feel like Motasa these days. Maybe you could use some opportunities to connect with someone as a sister, a brother, as a sibling in Christ. Who is your mother? Who are your siblings? Jesus asks and Jesus answers. Here.